Personally, I've learned a lot over the years in simply trying to tell people what was going on in terms of intergovernmental relations, which I then very much benefited from that in my own research. It's a complicated topic. I've been working on intergovernmental relations already for a very long time. Actually, it's why some people come to multi-level governments through international relations, from the top down, so to speak. I'm using the concept of intergovernmental relations already for about 10, 15 years, even before European integration really got its momentum. But intergovernmental relations, I used it, I come back to that concept. And so for me in this area, analyzing intergovernmental systems and doing the research in terms of European integration has always been very much intertwined. Out of that, apart from an early question, early interest in what does European integration mean for local government, and what does it mean for the way different levels of government interact, which I started to talk about already a long time before it became fashionable. I mean, now we have this multi-level governance hype, more or less, in many concepts, and become a very fashionable subject. But I was intrigued by that subject already for a long time, even when Europe was still something that was mainly for people interested in international affairs, and then we'll talk about local governments, particularly if local governments and the people working in local government themselves did not pay that much attention to the European developments. It's gradually improving, it's gradually changing, as a matter of fact, but so far it was not something that people were interested in. So I embarked for quite a while on the concept of regionalization there, which is for a Dutchman, particularly with Belgium next door, kind of a strange concept if you do that already in the early 1990s. As a matter of fact, I started out in the late 1980s, because like Denmark, the Netherlands has generally been presented as a country without regions, a unified country. Which, as a matter of fact, caused me a nice paradox, which I will not treat, because the Netherlands is a country with a high degree of factually regional pluralism. If you think about it historically, I mean, the country has always been divided in what we call three pillars. That's what political scientists talk about. Catholics, Protestants, and a general pillar which combines, that was the divided society. What people have often overlooked is what the Catholic pillar was basically in the south, the Protestant pillar was basically in the northeast, and the general pillar was in the Randstad area. So that provided to me a nice puzzle. And I think puzzle to intrigue students. I think that is one of the important things think about teaching this, is that you need to intrigue people, that you need to trigger their attention, because intergovernmental relations, local government, regional government, is generally not something that public administration students, who are more interested in the high politics of the national government, perhaps in bureaucracy, in management, of course, and all the things that come into that, they would like to pay attention to. So you need, I mean, something to trigger their attention. And an interesting way to do that is to present them some puzzles or some paradoxes. And paradoxes are seeming contradictions. And I'm not going to elaborate on this example. If you like, I can give you some references to how I use this paradox of the fact that the Netherlands did not have regionalism. Most people start now to pay attention. Oh, see the regions emerging everywhere. And so it's very uncommon, but sometimes it's interesting to start with the question, well, why wasn't there a regionalization in the Netherlands, for example? And then so that creates sometimes a lot of resistance, because you pay attention to things that they don't have thought about, you make them think. And I think that intergovernmental relations is a subject par excellence to make people think, which I personally think is the most important mission of any instructor. If you think about intergovernmental relations, it has been introduced here, I think also in class, basically as a topic which has become of interest to your students in European integration because of what I would call the implementation federalism. Meaning simply the fact that, as we all know, European integration is largely based on a concept in which the rules are set centrally and the implementation is done locally, or at least at the national scale. And so that this creates some kind of an interdependency between those various levels of government, which, well, the F word, we're not allowed to use it, but in practical terms, and I guess also Kai Pietz was referring to that in his first concept, there is a lot of quasi, if you like, but you don't need that concept that much, federal elements in the way it operates. It is a matter of interdependency, and once you have interdependencies across various levels of government, you know that intergovernmental relations are going to play an important role and need to be studied. So from the perspective, and that's why most people address it nowadays, and that's how you can start a class. You can design a class and take simply the structural funds or the implementation of directives and show the role of local governments, and that is a perspective, a puzzle, a way that you can address the subject of intergovernmental relations. But personally, I also like to present it usually, as I indicated already, as a classic in comparative public administration. In the past it was called federalism, or it was called centralization, decentralization, or it was called central-local relationships, or it was called local government autonomy, and the meaning of that. The only thing that has happened over the past 10 years is that we've gotten increasingly more comparative material. That might be striking. Now we have at least a little bit of a sense. You have available information also for your student what's going on in other countries. You might be surprised that only, in the early 1990s still, people were struggling to get some description about actually the nuts and bolts, the descriptive of what's going on in various countries. And still I think that in terms of comparative research, we're doing not a very good job in understanding the similarities within the commonality and the commonality within the similarities, the differences. So, as a matter of fact, it is a classical PA perspective. If you talk about functional prerequisites, whether it's East or West, we learn that in terms of good government, you need local governments, whether they have full autonomy or whether they are the form of deconcentrated services, but you need units at the regional level, you need to address the question of coordination at regional levels, and coordination across levels of government. These are very, very fundamental questions. I mean that then a student who doesn't want to do anything with Europe anymore, once he has it between his ears, can use in whatever context. I mean, if you then start to work within a national system or within a policy sector, there are some concepts that are of use basically, fundamentally, always. So in that sense, I think it's a very, also in sharpening your analytical. And a third consequence, but I will not talk about it much, but simply refer to it, is that there's a lot of what my research subject is public sector reform or administrative reform, say in the past 10, 20 years, and trying to explain the variation. And it has become clear to me that there's a lot of commonalities. People talk about a paradigm shift. By the way, this got a lot to do with European integration, but it's indirect impact of European integration on the systems. All public sectors in Western Europe, but not only that, have been reforming with new public management. But then again, at the same time, you see a lot of variation there in that. And in explaining these kind of variations, at least I've discovered that intergovernmental relations, the nature of intergovernmental relations, is a very important factor. I mean, it's very easy to explain reform, when it happens and what it happens, simply to begin with external circumstances. Without a crisis, little reform, usually. So you need a crisis or external pressure. And we had, of course, the economic crisis in the end of the 1970s, caused a lot, and since then, European integration has put a lot of pressure on the systems to reform. The second question then is, do you put a reform on the agenda politically, yes or no? So this is a matter of political leadership, the timing of those reforms. Are you late, early? I mean, you need to have some people that want to go against political leaders, go against the current, or wait. And they also shape the nature of the reform. Are you going to make a big statement? No, is it withering away of the state? The state is the problem, not the solution, that kind of big statements, or are you going to do it more softly, incrementally, step by step, introducing the reforms through the back doors? I mean, that is a matter of, it has to do a lot of with political style, also with political culture. And then, if you go a step further still, you see that there is much differences which has to do with the nature of institutional factors. I mean, if some people say, well, it's easier to reform unitary systems than it is to reform federal systems, that is a very commonplace observation. I'm not so sure whether that is the case always. There is a shadow of hierarchy in unitary systems, but you see a lot of unitary systems that reform, take of France, in a very incremental way. The second, so basic constitutional characteristics, the second institutional characteristic, which is very important in understanding reform, is the nature of the intergovernmental system. It is fair to say, if I look at the Netherlands, and I think if I would look at Scandinavian countries, and if I look at Germany, but then again, that's the commonality with all the difference also with Great Britain, that a lot of the reforms and the improvements of the budgetary situation within national systems has been done at the expense of local governments. A lot of the so-called reforms were actually overloading activities, and then they sometimes call it decentralization, offloading activities to the local governments, and you resolve it. And that is typically overlooked, by the way, by the new public management approach, but local governments do play a very crucial role if you look at the empirical reforms that you see throughout Europe. And then the nature of the system very much determines how this reform then will be the trajectory of reform, what a strategy is that you follow. I mean, if you know about England, that in England all authorities of local governments rely on a mandate of parliament, then you know that it is in principle possible to take away that mandate for local government by the national government. But if it's a simple fact, simple as that. And that is why Mrs. Thatcher at the time could start her reforms by taking an attack on the local governments. On top of that, I mean, if you then know, for example, a very basic fact, not in principle, that the intergovernmental relationships of England are traditionally characterized by a non-executive role of central government. A non-executive role of central government, meaning that they do not carry out their own activities, basically. And that is under that principle. In the past, the British welfare state was being built on this concept of the non-executive role of central government, and execution of tasks therefore was being done by the local governments. If you know that very simple fact, you can predict what's going to happen, because then the first suspect, once you have to roll back the state, is then to start with the local government. And you also can do it, because you have the potential, the opportunity. You have to clearly define tasks, that's nice for local governments, done by an act of parliament. It also means if you have the majority in parliament, you also can take them back, which would be impossible in the Netherlands, which would be impossible in Germany, which would be impossible in the Scandinavian states, because they have a general competence. So you can say, I stop my programs, but then local governments may quite well decide to pick them up on their own. And so, I mean, if you know some of these basic facts, you know why certain, can explain why certain reform strategies take a certain shape. And I'm very much surprised. I mean, there's a whole lot of interest on agencification and transaction costs, and it's a rational decision of the Next Steps program. But it's nonsense if you look at it from the intergovernmental perspective. If you take something away from local governments, because they're also doing a bad job, particularly in the political opinion of Mrs. Thatcher, then and you have this tradition of a non-executive role of central government, you're not going to do it yourself. You don't have the management capacity to do it yourself. You don't have the inclination to do it. Where do you leave those taxes? Well, there's two alternatives. The one alternative is that you give it to the market. And that is why the paradox, Mrs. Thatcher is centralizing. Well, she's not. She said, I'm not. I'm decentralizing, but I'm decentralized to the market instead of to local governments. So that made a difference. And if you don't want to give it to the market, because you can't, there are many things that you cannot give to the market, then you have to do it yourself, but you have this non-executive role, this tradition of a non-executive role of central government. So what you do? You have to create two special agencies for that. And in other countries, they call this functional decentralization, or département in France, and, or Regierungsbezirk in Germany. And if you know that, you know what's going to happen, the real next steps. That's precisely because if you know from those problems, they did that's what other countries have done. You know, that they don't carry out their own tasks, but tasks are being carried out with agencies who act under the responsibilities of central government. But then you have a problem of coordination, because how does the union, the agency for environmental affairs, interact with the agency for economic affairs? So eventually there will be a question, how do we coordinate this? In France, this has been resolved by creating the Parlement. In Germany, by the Regierungsbezirk. The next step of that is that the question is, oh, if you put together, you learn that again from Italy, if you put together a lot of those civil servants in the region who are all technically coordinating these kind of things, that's a powerful bulwark which is developing itself. And that means that the question of legitimacy automatically arises. Who is making the political choices? So there will inevitably come a demand for democratizing these kind of institutions like they've done in France. And that is precisely what you see at the moment in England. And I'm already for 4 or 5 years predicting that the outcome of the managerial reforms of Thatcher in England on the long run will mean that England is going to do something which they've always resisted in terms of intergovernmental relations, is to create a regional layer of government. So I'm just giving you an indication that intergovernmental relations is a very fundamental concept. Many students consider it a boring concept. It's not the most spectacular because it's not on the everyday agenda from headline news. It's a little bit the hidden dimension, one could speak of. So it is. You have to, the problem with that subject is you need to attract their attention. You need to make it. Why is it important? And then hopefully, perhaps the best use is not so much, although it is always very nice to know about the nuts and bolts and some of the differences, but is to focus and to concentrate on some of the analytical and the conceptual aspects of it. Even in a seemingly remote area, you can then use it as public sector reform and explaining the variation, something that typically would not come up in, for example, a managerial perspective on reform, which I think is far too limited if you want to understand what's going on. Now let me go and go back to the first subject. I mean, obviously, if you want to attract the attention of students at the moment, particularly students in Europe, it makes sense, and that is really a difference, to start in European development. If it's, as I said, comparative intergovernmental relations is about studying the differences in the commonalities and the commonalities in the difference. Up until 10 years ago, you only had very general concepts for that. What does decentralization mean? What does local government mean? What does federalism mean? So it was more a conceptual, almost, comparison. But what you now have is something that they all have in common. Namely, some kind of a common challenge, which is called European integration. Some kind of a common task, which is called the implementation of directives, or some kind of common opportunities, which people generally see in terms of regional funds, the regional structural funds, or the committee of the regions, or what have you. So you have something that everybody is, well, that is at least unified all over Europe. And then the question is, how come that different countries are doing different aspects with that same challenge? So that provides you an easy an easy introduction. I mean, that is probably, if you have to introduce people at an elementary level to that kind of subject, that is a good starting point. What I've been using, what you then do is, of course, start to talk about basically this model, the so-called state-centric model of European integration, the traditional model, the third pillar these days, one should say, but the way Europe is set up, it is still an intergovernmental system in a formal sense. I mean, it doesn't make any sense to talk as Europe, it still is an intergovernmental system. Period. Nothing else in the formal sense. A lot is going on within that intergovernmental system, but that is not so strange. Once you start to do things from an administrative point of view. But is the intergovernmental system, basically, it is an agreement between different governments who represent their societies in an intergovernmental organization, and they might decide to on some joint and common regulations, norms, or programs, which are then being implemented again by the national governments. National governments talk to each other, they talk to each other in Brussels. It's basically still, the fundamental setup is still that. And if you want to change it, it is now dependent on the convention, but let's see what comes out of it. But from a public administration perspective, that doesn't mean, and to me, public administration is about how government actually operates. Yeah. It's about the government in action, as Woodrow Wilson once defined, and a very commonly quoted definition. This is not government in action. This is a way to look at government in action. And you concentrate on governments. So, regional governments or local governments, national governments, intergovernmental organizations. So your focus, when looking at it, is intergovernmental. And perhaps that, from a public administration point of view, in order to understand the realities of European integration, has become too limited. And here you will find the deep-rooted explanation of the sudden explosion and in the popularity of the concept of governance. And why it makes has also some sense to think about it, but we should not attach more value to it than it actually does. Because this is the reality as it has been developing over the past 10 years, which is quick. Which is quick. I mean, I'm probably one of the few people that cannot understand all these Europe skeptics. I mean, it's tremendous what has been going on. And it still is, as a matter of fact. And I know it's academically very fashionable to criticize about everything about Europe, just like it is politically, by the way. Europe has become a common scapegoat. And things that they cannot resolve in the back home, say, oh, we have to do it because of Europe. And if there's a program that we like, reduction of taxes, or social exclusion, or renovation of cities, I say, wow, that's our program. I mean, the law once said 90% of the rules will come out of Europe. I'm convinced that at the moment now 90% of the policies are really coming out of Europe. Once, look at it, be critical about it. If one of your politicians comes with an innovative idea, he's probably just visited the European conference. And that is something that obviously we're not supposed to talk about, because we have to be critical of democratic deficit and everything that goes with it. It's a different subject. There is a lot going on, which of course has changed the way in which this intergovernmental system is operating. And it brought in the subnational elements, the regional levels, the local levels, the special interests at the local level. And so it didn't really, was very helpful anymore. It's an old model, it's from 1971, so it's nothing. If you talk about here, you talk about government. And if you concentrate on governments, it is too limited. And that is why here you have to start to focus on governance, which is the process. Personally, I prefer the concept of networks for that. Personally, I prefer the concept of mutual interdependency for that. That's enough. It's It's a well-grounded concept, which is good enough. But has led to an increase of interdependencies. And I reserve the concept of governance for where it comes from. Governance in a limited sense, because it is now, some of you observed already in the first class, it's about coming everything. It means everything, so it means nothing anymore. Everything is now these days governance. And a lot of people, it refers to networks. And to a lot of people, it refers to the fact that the interaction of various levels of governance and the inclusion of governmental and non-governmental actors in this process. But for that, we had already a concept which we called policy networks and the interdependency that you had within that. I mean, it were the accountants, basically, that introduced the concept of governance or discovered it. Because for a very long time they have been talking about management only, and then they discovered that management, which is a public administration wisdom, is a very very poor subject. Because managers are very well in achieving given goals at a minimum budget or maximizing or a maximum of goals with a given budget. But who gives the goals to them? Who sets the standards by which their performance has to be judged? That is part of the governance process. And this governance process is characterized by responsibilities. Governance, democratic governance, is about checks and balances. Division of labor between government, society, between the judicial, between the executive, between parliament. So it is already, in that sense, a multi-phenomenon. And suddenly they discover that things which typically fell outside the framework, the mind of people studying intergovernmental Europe, which were basically the intergovernmental and international relations people, and European specialists, they suddenly find these lobbyists there from the regions, and then it becomes multi-level. So this discovery of them, of the new phenomenon, which has become increasingly visible. But in that sense, I come back to that, I mean, is it still a very traditional way of looking at it? Well, then you can introduce this subject to students by going into the structural funds. People have been talking about it, so I will not. But it is a nice way of illustrating the difficulties, this new involvement of decision-making between various levels of government, regions, the conflict between regions and cities, the role of lobbying, which starts to play a role, matters of coordination. But also you can use this as a case to show a new form of doing governance. I mean, with the regional funds, was not only a lot of money, but also a new policy style was being introduced. If you look at the history, interaction. I mean, we now talk a lot about interactive government, maybe as if academics have invented it, but basically it was the requirement of the European Union that you would, in the case of structural funds, that you would collaborate not only as a government do things on your own, but collaborate with private organizations, with business, with associations from the civil service, that you were required to have some reviews done in advance and in the end. So doing some kind of, benchmarking is still not very well developed, but doing some kind of external review by reviewing committees. I mean, that was in most countries a very important impact of style of policy making. So you can use this as a case to elaborate that a little bit further. You also can use it, if you look at the European integration and structural funds and development, that Europe is penetrating deeper and deeper into the local governments. I mean, if you look simply at the statement of this urban mission, urban was a reaction of, say, Europe of the cities towards Europe of the regions. Hey, we have to pay attention to addressed under the structural funds. It means that it's about economic and social regeneration of cities and neighborhoods in crisis. Cities and neighborhoods in crisis. A European program about cities and neighborhoods in crisis. We can talk a lot about broadening Europe these days. But under this heading, a considerable amount of deepening. Under this heading of regionalization, Europe is doing something which they say that they don't do. namely developing a social policy. Oh, no social policy, that's the prerogative of member states. Europe is about economic integration, and Europe is about the capitalists. I've heard some people also say that. And of course, in the models, more simplified models of European integration, that is correct, you don't put them in there. But what does it mean if you talk about regeneration of cities and neighborhoods in crisis? What do you have to pay attention to? Social assistance, health, welfare, urban renewal. Who is really has the negative impact of noise, environmental policies. So there's a lot going on under that if you look at it from a perspective where actually, although there's no formal policy, we all made the mistake of looking at formal policies, in terms of intergovernmental relations and what that means, where governments interact, what is being shaped there. And it's going deep. It's four policy aims here: strengthening economic prosperity and employment in towns and cities, promoting equality, social inclusion, and the regeneration of urban areas, protecting and improving the urban environment towards global and local sustainability, and contributing to good urban governments and local government. I mean, if you know this, you know that there is going to be a white paper on government, and this is already four years old. That you knew that they were going to have to address the question of good urban governments and local empowerment and local and decentralization, and the way is the subject of subsidiarity, wasn't it? But under this heading, all kind of principles are being introduced. And is it bad? Is it good? I don't care. It simply is an objective. That is what's going on, and contributing to good urban governance. If you think a little bit further than automatically what's going to happen, I mean, you have all these programs which are being run not only by regions these days, but also by local governments. And these damned local governments make a lot of mistakes, which is usual. It's normal. We all make mistakes, isn't it? So, and some do it on purpose and some don't, and there's some good guys and bad guys. So a lot can go wrong with these European funds. So do you want to be kept responsible as a national ministry for every fault that's being made in some kind of a local municipality? Of course not. I don't want to bet. And it's got nothing. It's sharing the blame. How can I make local governments more accountable? Well, what did I say about the concept of governance? It's about accountability. So new forms of government, the governance is, of course, phrased in terms of increasing democracy and in terms of improving the quality of local governments and the participation of the citizens. That's standard language if you study intergovernmental relations. And there's all kind of nice ideals, but the reality is, of course, that they want to do some sharing of responsibilities. And not only the European level wants that, that's also what those national ministers say. No shit, I don't want to have my reputation in it for all kind of fraud or corruption or what else that's taking place in one region or another. So how can we share this kind of thing? So, and that's a strong current. I mean, that is a strong motivation of people to do this. One of the things I would like to pay your attention to, though, is one that I use very often in class to trigger the attention of students for the subject of intergovernmental relations, which they generally consider boring, which is the mechanism of government, is to make them aware about indirect impacts of European integration. We talk a lot about Europe, about the directives, about European decision making, about the acquis, about the structural funds. But there is a lot of indirect impact, which is perhaps more important, which affects them almost literally in a visible way. This is a very old picture, the way that the original regional debate in Europe was being framed. This is from the late 1980s, I think, that I've started to use this. I said, well, if you're going to have a single European market, so this was before 1992, so what is it going to mean if you're going to have one single European market? I mean, you cannot assume that everything will stay the same. I mean, a region has a market has spatial dimension to it. It means advantage to some regions or cities, it means a disadvantage to other cities. How is this going to develop? And how is it going to develop? Some people said, well, The future of Europe is the blue banana. The blue banana was the concept of what you saw from space in the early days. These days you won't see it anymore. It went to the internet, but things are nowadays so refined that it's so lightened up that you don't see the structure anymore. But in the past, we had pictures from an astronaut flying around space at night across Europe. There was a lighted area which lighted up a little bit blue, and they call that the blue banana. And this is the structure of cities ranging from center of England through this area here, the Ruhrgebiet, and Switzerland, northern Italy, towards Barcelona. And people say, well, that is going to be the traditional axe of cities, and that will be the major target for European developments. That's where you have to invest. If you're in this axe, if you're in this banana, then you're well off. I mean, your prosperity is guaranteed. But also, it provided some intriguing questions. As you see here, a large white unknown, which was true in those times, you know. And then people say, well, what was going to happen once the Berlin Wall tumbled? Does it mean that this blue banana is going to shift to the continent? Is that going to mean that Prague and Warsaw and Berlin and Budapest are going to take up their historical places? What does this mean for Paris, for example? They move to the periphery. Can you believe that? We'll accept that. Of course, speculation. But just to make people think about what the impact might be. And particularly after a while, people say, well, wait a minute. Because this is also Europe of the mega investments. This is Europe of the high networks, of the collaborating airports of Frankfurt and Schiphol. This is the Europe of the TGV. This is the Europe of the fast speed train in Europe. This is the Europe of the highways. This is the Europe of BMW, supporting highways too. So this is the Europe of the regions, why we call, because it's that level. Clearly not the states, they're getting less important, so is the regions. And then you already said to me, well, wait a minute, that is not correct. That's an old-fashioned concept. Is this the European Grey? The future of Europe? The future of Europe will be a constellation of urban areas, urban cities. Centers, urban centers, because that is the new economy at the time developing, and around them some regional areas, but basically it's going to be Europe of the cities. So you had an interesting debate, what is it going to be? Europe of the regions or Europe of the cities? And you could see some kind of a conflict coming up. Well, who's going to win in that kind of conflict? Everybody, of course, said, well, in Germany is going to be the lender. They're very well positioned to take their regional interests. But now we've discovered that even in Germany, and that's why the Germans are so keen on the concept of governance, by the way, that the real developments in terms of regionalization are now taking place indeed at the level between the city of München and Bayern. And so it's the area which is not being covered by formal entities. So this is not a model to say, but just to trigger people into, trying to get their attention to it. Because over time, of course, you get some interesting, if this idea fits, some interesting other maps. This is a recent one. I'm constantly collecting these things from because we need maps to make it visible. It's a highly abstract concept. Intergovernmental relations, regionalism is a high level. And usually we're stuck with the maps, the ones I showed you, the formal regions. That's what we have. But can we also make visible some of the other elements? Well, what you have here is France. You all see that. But the interesting part is what they did after what the TGV was doing to France, which you can make visible in a way. What does the TGV do to France in terms of accessibility? We have always come to learn that Paris, of course, is the center of France. But the way things developed, and these developments are under the impression of the European integration, the single European market, The nature of France, particularly the location of some cities in France, changes. Here, if you go back, we'll put them together. Lille, a very remote corner once in France, couldn't be further away from Paris than you think. A few years later, Lille is a suburb of France, literally. Of course, with all the problems that come with it, like fugitives, like minorities, like drugs, criminal activities that you find with it, and all the typically urban type of problems. In a different fashion, I mean, in the past, it used to be a somewhat worn out, outdated city with an old infrastructure, poor, and there was, of course, some in terms of regional policies, that was the way it was being addressed. But these days, what are we talking about? Is a big fight between Germany and England whether or not this fugitive center should be closed that they have there at the Channel. That has also always to do, suddenly you're being transported to another part of France or to another part of the Netherlands, as a matter of fact, because that's what you need to make clear to people, that it's not only about structures, that's very important for people, it's about substance. But real things that happen to their lives, and of course then structures start to play a role. This is the Netherlands. A map of, I think it's Rotterdam is the center, so it's the Rotterdam newspaper, of course if this would have been the Amsterdam newspaper, it would have been something different. And putting Rotterdam and then traveling distances, of course Groningen, Leeuwarden, Assen, Emmen, Monaco, and here, it's Brussels, Antwerp, that's Eindhoven, Philips. And the impact, if you would have some new finished railways in the Netherlands, including perhaps some high-speed trains. And suddenly you see that a country like Groningen, which to a Dutch person, if you would say you go to Groningen, you move to the other side of the world, I mean, it's only 3 hours drive, but for Dutch, but that's eternity, if you have to go, but that's... suddenly, Groningen is transported from there to there, in terms of accessibility. What do you think that this means? In terms of housing prices? In terms of physical infrastructure, in terms of poverty, in terms of unmarried women with small children, which are really, if you look at the real social, the people where there's real poverty, it's there. And if you look at social assistance programs, they suddenly move because there they can get cheap housing. And suddenly this social assistance unit in Groningen is being confronted with a problem that they never faced before. Because it's not suddenly, it goes gradually. Because it goes gradually, you don't see it happen really. And nobody's paying attention to you about it. So suddenly you're confronted with an enormous problem. Oh, we didn't know. I mean, these are the problems, the creeping, see how you want, problems, gradually developing problems. So you can show these, use these kind of things. Look at here. Suddenly, Schiphol. Yeah. I mean, a lot of talk in the Netherlands whether there should be an airport near Rotterdam, because in the Netherlands typically is always a rivalry between Amsterdam and Rotterdam, and Schiphol Airport. Yeah, it's Amsterdam. You don't go as a Rotterdam person to Schiphol to Amsterdam. You need your own airport. There's been a big fight about there's a small airport or a small business airport that should be enlarged in the middle of a big urban area. It's ridiculous, like Hong Kong. But here, a little bit about this, the changing infrastructure. Suddenly, Schiphol is in the middle of Amsterdam, The Hague, and Rotterdam. It's a completely different setup in terms of mind. I mean, in the Netherlands, if you live, and that's typically what our students, this is how you attract their attention. Because students in the Dutch case are typically mostly recruited on a regional basis. So that means that a student from The Hague is The Hague. But there are people that never come and never meet and never go, would go to one of those other cities. But they have a completely different mindset. But look at this. So this is a whole. And then you go a step further and say, well, What is this? And you tell them this is Manhattan. There's Central Park here. Green heart. And of course the shore, Jersey. Statue of Liberty is just outside this picture. And of course you have a subway system which connects all those. You need to take care of that subway system. This is Rotterdam. This is The Hague. This is Amsterdam. This is Utrecht. Presented as if it was. That was wicked. One interconnected system. Which is of course happening under the impact of these kind of regional developments. So this is just an example, and there are many more, of how indeed you have to give it some effort to bring the subject to the people. But then once you do that, it is very intriguing. Now what I then use to round it off a little bit is that multi-level governance, and I said, well, this is a traditional view, it has been discovered. And some people say, well, multi-level governance is an old concept, which has to do with the fact that you had the state as a sovereign power, which was all the way around, linked to the European market, whose interests are being represented by the European Commission, basically. And the state then, of course, was obliged, committed to standardize terrorist protection and subsidies, to buy off various regions, and the idea then was, in support of that, that the regions would give political support and seek representation at the state level. And so this is what people call the traditional model of multi-level governance. And nowadays there is a so-called modern model, which said, well, okay, next to the state, we have discovered the region, and the perspective of the region has changed dramatically under the impact of the European integration. On the one hand, we have European institutions, lobbying mechanisms, Committee of the Regions, direct representation in Brussels, there are lobbying organizations. Sometimes they operate through the state apparatus, through the intergovernmental conferences, through the national ministries that they can use. Sometimes they have their direct links. And so this is a lot of attention that is being paid to multi-level governance. But there is also another dimension coming to it, and that is that nowadays, with the Europeanization, does not only mean Brussels, Strasbourg, or Luxembourg, but is a market. So, for the regions, it is becoming a consideration, where do I position myself? Where do I direct my strategy? And there are all kind of trade-offs that you can talk about. I mean, and this is, I could say, the latest model that you then can use to talk about these kind of things. What do? You go for a competitive advantage, bypassing the state? Most people say, well, the regions try to bypass national states and go directly to Brussels. Or, because there's an enormous coordination problem, might it actually in the long run imply the state is still at the center, I hope you realize that here, so the national government. So it might quite well be that the national government's position is different, changing, but not necessarily less important. I think it's a big mistake. Personally, that's one of the messages I bring across in class already for a long time, that people think that European integration amounts to a weakening of national government. It might amount to a weakening of the nation state concept as the closed shop of national governments. It's a hierarchically structured system, and that's what we've seen in many cases. But does that automatically mean that national governments are becoming less important? I don't think so. I think that vis-à-vis European Commission, 18,000 civil servants, what can I do?
Nothing.
Leicester, if I took the Netherlands, central civil service, what is it, 125,000, 130,000, 10 times as much almost. So, if I think in terms of city, City of Rotterdam has more civil service than the European community has, if they get their act together, as local governments typically do, don't. Because they're fragmented, but then you need to know something about local governments, in not monoliths. So if the central governments, they might lose the nation state concept, but if they adopt it, they might exploit their position, the strategic position, in the middle of this governance network, where they can provide legitimacy, where they can provide expertise, where they, if they know how to play the game, in connecting difference, they can completely start become the most important players within this governance network. But in any case, the intergovernmental relations will become more and more important, and they will become different. In the sense that it is not, you don't have only to think in terms of the real traditional layers of government anymore, which is still, which this model is still based on, but you have to think in terms of other capacities as well. Because the position of European institutions, the position of these states institutions, the position of these regions, does not only depend on formal positions, the way it's being written into the constitution, the local government act, whatever, but it also depends on the type of policies. It makes a difference if you go into social policy or you do infrastructure policy. Infrastructure policies are generally in the hands of the upper tier local governments in Europe, if you know that. Of the upper regions, they take care of the infrastructure. Whereas everything that is related to the social infrastructure is typically in the hands of municipalities. And this makes an enormous difference in terms of managing. It makes a difference of the capacity that people need to have. So in this case, it is not only, you don't only talk about structures, you talk about policies, and you talk about, you can use it to talk about managerial capacities. Because in this state, in this department, you do not perhaps need that much civil servants anymore that can write a policy report or that can write a paper. You need completely different type of competencies. People with public affairs competence, people that can network, people that can organize activities. So the organizing capacities are becoming perhaps much more important than the policy making capacities. You see, organizing capacities, not necessarily the management capacities. Management capacities are very often internally related. So it, from here on, you can start to build in various different directions, I think, a program. You can, from here on, I could talk what you could do, but I think the most important thing I wanted to make for this morning was that it is possible, but absolutely necessary, if you talk about multi-level governments, that you try to invest, and it's worthwhile these days, and it's more and more material out there on the web. You make it visible. That's why I'm in favor of recording these kind of things, not necessarily professors, because that doesn't make that much sense. But if you start to use, if you can use the web, videotapes, clips, in addition to the maps that I had, it makes it far more lively subject. And then once it's alive, you can use that to introduce some fairly basic concepts of public administration, like centralization, decentralization, like local government autonomy. And if you talk about local government autonomy, you also talk same type of problems. You talk about the autonomy of bureaucrats or the autonomy of politicians. You can talk about coordination, you can talk about policy making, you can talk about interactive government, whatever you like. But it is first I think most important is to show that you're not only talking about structures, but you're talking about some kind of a real substance which affects you. That is, I think, the most important goal of academic research, is to make people think, to confront them with unexpected things, with paradoxes. At least that is my conviction. You know, people that say, well, I tell you things you need to know. But I think that the most important gift of an academic, at least, is that he's able to use his mind, or her mind. And you need to train that every now and then. And this subject has a lot of these paradoxes, a lot of these conflicts, a lot of these contradictions, which can make people angry with, because of course it's a very sensitive process. I mean, the fact that we can talk about it already, about the Belgian state process now, 10 years ago that would be impossible. I mean, as long as I get some spunk in people, or that they get intrigued, or that they get thinking and angry and motivated, that's what it is. And that's perhaps the most important thing that a professor can achieve. At least that is my my experience also, if I look back and the things that have meant most to me when I was in class, and that really lasted. And I think that this is what I've discovered has been the most, that gives me a lot of fun as well. People get angry. Of course, you make them think in a way that they've never done before, and then they you shake their beliefs, and that is, that's always fun. Sometimes you get an angry class, but you take that for granted. Questions? Or shall we leave it in? See you again Friday morning.